What's going on, y'all? It's Damien with the DevSec Blueprint. And in today's video, what we're going to be doing is performing DAST scans against web applications using OWASP ZAP. If you haven't taken a look at the video that I created explaining SAST and DAST concepts, I highly recommend you take a look at that video before proceeding with this video, just so you have a foundational understanding of what DAST is. And without further ado, let's just get right into it. All right, so before we get started with explaining the concepts like Docker and also OWASP ZAP and proceeding with the technical activity, there are a couple of things that I need you guys to have installed on your local machine. The first thing that you're going to need is Docker. And the reason why is because we're going to be executing ZAP in a Docker container and we need Docker to do that. The second thing that I'm going to have you guys installed or need to have installed is Git. And the reason why is because we're going to be cloning repositories, and I'm going to include all the repositories that we're going to be using in the description as well. And the third thing, which is optional, is VS Code. And that's essentially just because I typically use VS Code to be able to track and make changes to the README files and stuff like that. And it's a very nice IDE to have installed on your local machine just to begin with. So completely optional, but if I were you, I would install VS Code to keep track of your Git changes and version control history. So now that the prereqs are out of the way, let's talk a little bit about OWASP ZAP. All right, so what is OWASP ZAP? So OWASP ZAP is basically a penetration testing tool that helps developers and security professionals detect and find vulnerabilities within web applications. So the key thing about this tool is that it acts as a automated penetration testing tool that tries to find various different vulnerabilities within your web app. And the key thing about OWASP ZAP is that it can identify vulnerabilities that fall within the OWASP top 10, such as security misconfigurations, you have SQL injection, cross-site scripting, et cetera, et cetera. The thing about OWASP ZAP is that there are several different types of capabilities and different scan modes. Active and passive scans are two different types of scans that you can configure in ZAP. And the difference between active and passive scans is that with passive, it basically checks the HTTP request and application's response for known indicators, versus active scans are generally more effective at finding it because it starts to inject various different requests that surface vulnerabilities. So think of passive scanning would be like, oh, I'm trying to check to see if anything exists without actually attempting to penetrate the application or attempt to fuzz the application in some weird way. So in regard to like scanning a web application or production environment, you definitely want to do more of a passive scan rather than a active scan, because an active scan could potentially take something down, right? So as it says here, passive scans pose a low risk as it cannot change the data. However, these scans cannot catch many vulnerabilities, including aggressive vulnerabilities like SQL injection. And there's different types of plugins that ZAP supports, or different types of software. So you can install it in Docker, or you can download it on a container. You can also install it on a desktop. You can spin it up as a web application or an application somewhere and trigger it via an API. There's different types of ways that you can execute a ZAP scan against a web application. And also what I like to mention is that this is open source. So you can download this and use it for free. You don't have to pay for it like some of the other DAST scanning tools that I've mentioned in previous videos. All right, so now that we've covered OWASP ZAP, let's talk more about Docker and what it means for us to execute a Docker container. So this platform, in a sense, has the ability or provides us the ability to be able to package and run our applications, whether it be a web application or just a regular like Flask application with just API support, in a way where it is deployed in an environment called a container, which allows us to be able to basically run it in an isolated form. So when we create a container, it basically provides us not only isolation from our system, but also it provides various different security benefits, if you want to run various different containers simultaneously on a given host. The beautiful thing about these containers is that they're very lightweight and they can contain everything that you need to run an application. And these containers are created based on the images. The images are something that you can build with a Docker file. So what can you use Docker for? Well, you can use Docker to be able to test and deploy your code in a containerized format. The good thing about Docker is that it has support for CI/CD platforms and workflow. So it just makes it a lot easier to deploy your code in an isolated way. In addition to that, for our particular use case, we're going to be using Docker to scan our web application. And the beautiful thing about that is that you don't necessarily have to download dependencies of OWASP because it's all going to be included in that Docker container, such as Java, for example. You need the Java JRE or JDK in order to be able to run OWASP ZAP. And in order for you to get that, you have to go and download it. And there are various different types of JDKs. You see my point that I'm getting is that it eliminates a lot of that complexity. You don't necessarily have to worry about it. So in this particular case, if we go down, you can see the Docker architecture. You can see how, you know, the client basically runs Docker run, build, or pull. And what pull will do is it'll pull the image. Build will build an image based on a Docker file. And then the run will actually run the image. So you can see that there are different types of images that are created or uploaded to the Docker repository. Think of it as like the GitHub of Docker images, the repository itself. You can pull down like a Python-specific image, a Redis-specific image. You can pull down like an HTTP or an Apache image. There are so many different things that you can do. And you can run all of that locally on your machine. All right. So now that you have a fundamental understanding of Docker and how it works and some of the key concepts of it, let's get right into the technical activity. This is the most exciting part, so I hope you're ready for it. Let's get right into it. Okay, so let's get started. The first thing that you're going to want to do is have the TWAP web application, or just TWAP, checked out on your local machine. If you haven't checked that out already, you can take a look at the description, and you can get the link to this repository, which will have the link to the TWAP repo that you can clone, as well as, you know, all the instructions and an explanation about ZAP and all the other stuff like that. So the first thing that you're going to want to do is just git clone it. I've already cloned it. And you want to CD into that directory. And the next thing that we're going to do before we even install ZAP on our machine using Docker is we're going to spin this up with Docker Compose. So I'm already CD'd into that directory. So I'm just going to go Docker Compose backd. And essentially what that's going to do is it's going to pull down all the Docker containers that it needs and the images and build one big image or a container and then start the application in detached mode, which means that it's running in the background. If you don't want to run it in detached mode, you can just remove the tagd and you can see like all the logs for the web application. But I don't think it's necessary. So that's going to take a little bit of time, but as you can see with my system, it's already done. So the network has been configured and we have the database for it and the application. So now that that's taken care of, we basically just want to verify that it's up and we can just basically go and copy this link and paste it into our web browser. I'm not going to do that because I tested it before, so I know it's up. So now that we've done that, what you're going to want to do is just kind of scroll down a little bit. And what we're going to do is actually run the command to basically execute ZAP against this and generate a report with all the vulnerabilities in HTML so that we can review that in a web browser. So if you scroll down in this README, and this README is going to be checked in, is you want to copy whichever command you've installed Docker on and you're running on. I'm unfortunately running on Windows at this time. So I'm going to copy this PowerShell command here, I'll document it, and then I'm basically going to execute this against the web application that's been spun up, right? And what this command basically does is that it mounts the current directory that we have on our local to the directory inside of the container. And then it also tells the network that we're basically allowing the ZAP Docker container to interact with our local host network. So there's two different types of networks. And what we're gonna do is run a full scan, which is an active scan against this web application, and then generate a report from it. So there's a lot of things that are happening in this command, but you can have the explanation of the command right here in this documentation. So let's go ahead and let's execute this. And this is actually going to take a little bit of time. So I will say just step away for a little bit. All right. So assuming you stepped away and came back, you can see that there are a bunch of logs here in our shell. So you can see that it was able to find quite a bit of information. We got no fails. We got a couple of warns, and we got a lot of passes. And it also dumped that into a scan report that we can see. If we click it, we'll open it. We can look at it, which is basically scan report that is highlighted here. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to open this up in a web browser so that we can see what this looks like, because no one wants to read HTML, right? So
drag it off over here.
I'm going to open it up and you will see this. So this is the ZAP scanning report that we got from scanning our web application. And if you look here, you can see that it gives us a summary of the alerts and also the alerts. And you can see that it gives us alerts by name, the risk level, and then the number of instances. So if it is the exact same vulnerability that it catches and gives us a certain amount of times, it was able to catch that within a web application. So let's take a look at one of these mediums, right? So let's see, let's do source code disclosure SQL. So we click that. What it's going to do, it says the description is application source codes disclosed by the SQL server or web server SQL. And you can see that inside of that login, it was able to find this within the code, which is select username, password from users, where username, block, right? So the beautiful thing is that it will also give us a solution. And the solution to this particular fix or this particular vulnerability would be ensure that web application source code is not available with alternative extensions, and ensure the source code is not present within other files or data deployed to the web server. So essentially, all this code should be on the back end. It shouldn't necessarily be on the front end, and I believe that's exactly where it's picking it up, which is good. But I can also misunderstand that as well. Also, when you look at some of the other vulnerabilities, you can see that it says application error disclosure. So you can see that, you know, evidence is internal server error. And it's the description of this vulnerability, which is a no risk, is that this page contains an error warning message that may disclose sensitive information, like the location of the file that produced an unhandled exception. This information can be used to launch further attacks against a web application, basically by giving whoever the attacker is a feedback, which is something that most attackers would really want anyway, because they want to see how your application responds. So they get to learn more about that, right? So if they see that it's giving an internal server error, then they may try to exploit that alert more, or they may try to find other things that could potentially give them more context as to how they can penetrate your application even further. And that wraps up this video, y'all. Thank y'all so much for watching, and I hope you were able to learn a little bit about ZAP and how to execute it using Docker. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, please drop me a note. Also, like, subscribe, and comment on the channel. Let me know what you thought about this video and various others as well. If you think this will be beneficial to anyone that you know, please make sure you share that. And I look forward to seeing you all in the next video. Thank you so much again. Later. Thank you.